Amen.
Well, let's stand for our call to worship. Call to worship is always a reading from Scripture that focuses on God's character, so reminds us of God's character. But as we're reminded of God's character, it should also cause us to think back on our lives and how we've been blessed by God's character. So let's read Psalm 117. Praise the Lord, all the nations. Extol him, all the peoples. For great is his steadfast love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Let's praise the Lord in song as we sing, This is my Father's world. Bow your head and pray with me, please. God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the only true God, the one that we come and gather together and humbly bow down to worship this day. We recognize you as the Ancient of Days, the great I Am, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our eternal Father, your sovereign reign and rule are always good and right, both over the nations and over our very lives. Your love is expansive, patient, and sacrificial. We love you because you first loved us. And not by just telling us that you loved us, but by demonstrating your love through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Your power knows no boundaries or limits. You move mountains and you move hearts. Your grace is truly amazing. You forgive our sins through the shed blood of your Son, even though that is totally undeserved. You are holy, holy, holy. There is no darkness in you. There is no one like you. You are unique. You are perfectly consistent. Your character is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And now as your people, we pray the model of prayer that Jesus taught his very first disciple, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now, using the Apostles' Creed, which will be on the screen, to declare what we believe, not only what we believe in common, but what brothers and sisters in Christ believe in common around the world. Brothers and sisters in Christ, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. This pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? Be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness.
God, from whom all blessings flow.
God's word says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19, Paul says, inspired by the Holy Spirit, and my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Pray with me. Father, we are so thankful that you don't give us everything that we ask for because we think we need what we're asking for. But Father, only you know perfectly what we need. And so we thank you for how you provide our needs and many of our wants as well. Father, help us to realize that our greatest need, our greatest blessing is the spiritual riches that we have in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, help us to be content in what we have and what we don't have, and help us to especially be content in the riches that we have in Jesus. And we pray in his name, amen. Please be seated.
It's a strong word of encouragement in that psalm, isn't that? In there, that when we cried out in panic, Lord, where did you go? He heard our prayers. He was right there. He has promised to never leave us nor forsake us, even when we don't feel his presence. He has made that promise to us. Let's pray. Lord, as we read your word, we thank you for that great promise that wherever we are in our walk today, with whatever feelings and emotions and questions we have, that you are near and that you are for us. And so we pray your blessing on the reading and hearing and proclamation of your word, to your glory and the good of your people. In Jesus' name, amen. The word of God, Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. Judge not that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you see the speck that's in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that's in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye when there is a log in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Do not give dogs what is holy, and do not throw your pearls before pigs, lest they trample them underfoot and turn to attack you. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and it will be opened to you, for whoever asks receives. And the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. Or which of one of you, if his son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? So whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Amen. Last week we considered Jesus' triple admonition about worry. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry, he says. We noted that there's a difference between fear and worry or anxiety. Likewise, as we read Jesus' oft-repeated admonition regarding judgment, it's critical that we note there's a difference between judgment and discernment. I've seen some of you do this at the produce department. Okay? You don't just take the first piece of fruit that you pick up, you look at it, you smell it, you lick it. Okay, you don't lick it. But you inspect it carefully, and rightfully so. And so the implication is not that if someone comes to your door and knocks and says, I'm here to sell you solar panels, that you just say, sure, put them up. I'm here to sell you securities. Yeah, let's get my checkbook out. No, no, we don't do that. It doesn't mean we don't set boundaries for our children about whom they play with, where they'll go, where they can spend the night. If someone says to me, it doesn't matter who shows up to take my daughter out, I'm like, are you crazy? Yes, it does. Or who you're going to let your children get in a vehicle and go off with? No, I've seen him drive. No, no, not happening. So clearly, Jesus is not saying at this point we should not exercise discernment or judgment. Otherwise, what he says in verse 6, do not give dogs what is holy and do not throw your pearls before pigs, doesn't make any sense. Or in verse 15, where we'll pick up next week, beware of false prophets. Clearly, we are to make some distinction. So if we stop with verse 1, as so many people do with this verse, judge not that you be not judged, we will exercise no discernment about anything. Except I really disagree with what you're saying. Wait a minute. I thought we were not exercising any discernment about anything. If this is true, and it's not, then we've missed the meaning of this verse. Jesus explains there's a difference between judgment and discernment, and to be judgmental is to maintain an attitude of judgment, and particularly it leads us to judge harshly. A judgmental attitude inevitably leads us to a harshness of our spirit, where we're not even able to receive forgiveness. If we're always right and everyone else is always wrong, and our job is to point out the wrongs in everybody else, we're not in a place to receive forgiveness because we don't need it. Discerning is defined as showing insight or understanding. And so what Jesus is condemning here is an attitude of judging others where we give ourselves the benefit of the doubt every time. And discerning is commended by Jesus, indeed, as a necessary human trait. If judge not that you be not judged means just that period, then it pretty much nullifies what Jesus says through most of the Sermon on the Mount. We see this in Jesus' life in Luke chapter 7, verses 36 to 50, Jesus is eating at the home of a Pharisee. He's been invited there. And a woman comes in, and she begins weeping at his feet and using her hair to clean his feet. And then she anoints his feet with oil. And the Pharisee is thinking, and it says this, he is thinking to himself, if this man was really a prophet, he would know what kind of woman is messing with him right now. And it says that Jesus says to him, I'd like to ask you a question. And he proposes a question. Two people owe some money. One owes a great deal. One owes a little bit. One, they're both forgiven their debts. Who do you think loves more? He goes, I suppose the one that was forgiven more. He goes, you do realize that since I've been in your house, you did not greet me with a kiss. She's not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil. She's not stopped anointing my feet with oil. And he draws this comparison here, and he's making clear this difference. The man with the log in his own eye is not blind to the speck in his brother's eye. He's blind to his own blindness. And so the Sermon on the Mount is about relationships, based on a relationship with God, whereby he becomes our Father, and Jesus teaches us to call God our Father in prayer through the finished atoning merit of Christ alone, that we are received by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. We have that relationship, or as he'll say at the end, we've entered by the narrow gate, which is the path of life. But primarily, it's focused on our relationships with each other, within the family of God, members of the family of God, but also just within the overall human family. How we treat others matters. So how we think about others matters. It does. Criticism is not a spiritual gift. The ability to always be able to see the flaw in another's actions or ideas or priorities and then point them out is not commended in the Scriptures. Charles Spurgeon says this, officiousness pretends to play the oculist, but in very truth it plays the fool. You know what he just said? What he says, We think we are so much more intelligent than people of yonder years. They understood that. And we're like, what? Officiousness. Unsolicited, well-intentioned meddling. Okay? Nobody asked you, but you see what's wrong. You're going to speak into it. You're going to fix it. You're going to... And you mean well. He says, you play the oculist, the optometrist, the ophthalmologist. You see what's in your brother's eye, but actually you're playing the fool. Okay, so I'm overweight, but you're obese. And the reason I'm overweight is I'm big boned. But you're a glutton. You see how that begins to play out. And every turn we give ourselves that benefit. Jesus makes this over-the-top analogy and illustration here. We know what it's like. If you've ever worn contacts, you've probably had at some point said, I don't know where my contact went. And you get somebody to look in your eye and find your contact. And you've probably done that for others. It's weird. You're looking around. Oh, there it is. I got something in my eye. Can you see what's in my eye? We'll do that. But if you're in a sandstorm on the beach and your eyes are full of sand and they say, I've got something in my eye, can you look? I can't look until my eyes are clear. And Jesus, in this imagery here, and saying, you got a log in your eyes, calling us to be generous with love and generous with forgiveness and generous with kindness in the very same way that God has been generous with us. He didn't always use humor in dealing with hypocrisy. In John 8, we have a woman who was rightfully charged with adultery, and they were ready to judge her with stoning. And you remember, he says, he who is without sin among you, let him throw the first stone. And when they all walk away, he says to the woman, go and sin no more. Jesus is not teaching us here that we just accept any teaching, any lifestyle, that we just trust everybody with everything, nullifying the rest of this sermon. Verse 16, he will say, you will recognize them by their fruits. So to love someone doesn't mean, it cannot mean, that we support and approve of everything they do. But he is calling us to be mindful of how we interject into people's lives. If we begin a conversation with someone, you know that I love you. Have you ever had that conversation? Someone said, you know that I love you. What comes next? Yeah. And yeah, you've had that conversation. It may be accurate. It may not be accurate. But you know to hang on. If we do that to someone every time, they're going to be looking for another way to go when they see you coming. When we tell someone what they did, and then we offer our interpretation and our speculation about why they did it and what they really meant, when we write someone off in our life based on the worst decision that they've made, and we say there's no room for reconciliation, That's cancel culture, and that mentality is entirely contrary to what Jesus says here. We are to be discerning. Can you imagine an adoption agency that says, come one, come all, we'll hand you a child? Like, what? No, we want to be very discerning about who gets our children. It gets crazy when the tables are turned and the measure is turned. And so up in a northeastern state, there's 1,500 people and children in waiting for adoption. And a couple is denied because they're Christian. How the tables have turned. That's using a different measure. The old story is this. A fellow dies. He gets to heaven. St. Peter greets him. He looks at the list. He says, you're on the list. There's one last requirement. Theologically, that's wrong. There is no more requirements. But there is for this story, and you have to spell a word. He says, what's the word? The word is love. Oh, okay. He spells it. He's in. St. Peter's beeper goes off, and he says, oh, man, I've got to take this. I'll be back in a few minutes. Can you cover the gate until I get back? I can do that, because don't forget, you've got to ask him about the word. So he goes immediately. His next door neighbor, who he has had a dispute with for years, shows up. And he's like, what happened? Well, anyway, he says, your name's on the list. Only one thing left. You got to spell a word. What's the word? Czechoslovakia. Jesus says, no, we don't use different measures, one for ourselves and another for others. In fact, he says the measure we use toward others is the measure we invite to be used toward us. And yet Jesus warns, do not give dogs what is holy. Do not throw your pearls before pigs, lest they trample them underfoot and turn to attack you. So we are to exercise discernment. And here he's talking about those who are actively hostile to the gospel and to the kingdom of God, to God's right and sovereign rule over his creation and his creatures, and to do it his way. But beloved, this is not something that we quickly, hurriedly, we make an early determination. Well, clearly you're a swine. I don't have to deal with you. Oh, no, no. In fact, early in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, let your light shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Let it be a testimony to all. And at the very end of Matthew, we have the Great Commission given to take the gospel into all the world and make disciples. But Jesus also said, if you go and the message is just totally, objectively, hostily rejected, then shake the dust off your feet We'll read that in Matthew chapter 10. And the early practice of the church, as we see in Acts, was at times they did that. Not often, but at times where the gospel, and it was just hostile, it was okay to leave and to move on. They had done what they could. Jesus turns to prayer in this regard, and he calls us to keep on praying, to ask and keep on asking, seek and keep on seeking, knock and keep on knocking. In other words, to be passionate and have our mind and heart engaged. If it's not something you're passionate about, then why in the world would you take it to the King of Kings and into the throne room of heaven? Lord, I don't really care about this, but I'm going to mention it in prayer because you're going to do it. No, that's not how it works. In fact, the lesson over the summer with our children in the story of Esther, when she is faced with a decision and finally she says that she will go in at great risk to see the king, and if I perish, I perish. What she has said is, this is worthy of the risk. I am passionate about this. I care deeply about this. And so I can go to the king and ask him to care deeply about it because he cares deeply for me. And that's the idea of this prayer. That if we don't really care about it, but if we do, then we can bring it to the Father because that's our relationship with him. And we can know that he gives good things to us in that regard. And so the contrast is with a parent. And not just a Christian parent, any loving parent. If your child asks for bread, are you going to give him a rock? If your child asks for fish, are you going to give him a serpent? And furthermore, a good, wise, discerning parent, if your child asks for a serpent, are you going to give him a serpent? No. Because we know what is best for them. Being a parent isn't always fun or easy. But we have to do what is good and what is right. And so Jesus drives this point home, and it's all, we can see it's all coming together in this idea of how we treat others. And he says, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give you what you ask? How much more? And then he doesn't tell us how much more. Spurgeon says he leaves that blank because he wants us to imagine how much more and to think big on that. And then this folds into the golden rule. Jesus is on this sermon and he comes here. Not only that we're not to judge others, but the measure is that we would, we don't want them to judge us. We want to do better than that. The end of chapter 5 in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus asked him, what more are you doing than others? And so verse 12, so whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. Again, it's about relationships. It's about how we treat one another. The greatest commandment, likewise, sums up the law and the prophets. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. It's the golden rule. Were indeed the way people live with one another. Spurgeon says, all would be justice and love. What a kingdom is this which has such a law? We get what Jesus is saying here. If the golden rule was the law and everybody followed it, how many other laws would we need? Not too many. Not too many. Understanding this is not the issue. Obedience is the issue. And we see we all fall short of living out the golden rule. A teenage boy was visiting his friend who was showing him his brand new, very cool car. He says, how in the world did you get a car like that? He goes, my brother gave it to me. He goes, your brother gave it to you? I wish... What? He said, I wish I could be a brother like that. That's the golden rule. I wish I could love like that. I wish I could give like that. I wish my heart was there. As a matter of judgment and discernment, Jesus says that we are to make a choice and then to take action. Enter by the narrow gate. Enter. Not just think about it. Not just have intentions about it. Not just agree it's a good idea, but enter by the narrow gate. And it's not because it's the first thing that will catch our attention or draw us. The gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. So it calls for judgment. Not all paths lead to life. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Verse 14. The most popular path is not usually the way that leads to life. Even to note that is to stir some pushback, some argument about that, some dispute. Well, that's judgmental. Of course, they are judging Jesus and what he said at that point. He is the one who says this. It's a warning, and it's for our good, and it's for life. The way that Jesus calls us to is not the most popular way. He never said it is. It's not the easiest way. He never said that either. It's not mob mentality. It's not getting caught up in the flow of culture. It's not bought off by promises made by those who can't possibly fulfill those promises. No one else can offer us the way of life and back up that promise. And it can happen because Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. There really are two different paths, but actually only two. There's the path that leads to destruction. It may seem like there's many paths there, but there's not. It's just really broad, really wide, and really easy. And the other path is the path to life. Wide is the gate. What that means, if wide is the gate, you can take it all with you. You can take your pride. You can take your sinfulness. You can take your self-righteousness. You can take your judgmentalism. You can take all of it and be your own God and be on that broad path of life. You don't have to put any of it down to get through the gate. And we can think that we're making our way to the pinnacle of glory and that, hey, this is actually pretty easy, when we're actually winding our way down to the pit of destruction. And we don't even know it. We're oblivious because our eyes are on ourselves and we become the standard of what is right and good. Well, this is what's right to me. The gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. Why would Jesus say such a thing? That's not very attractive or winsome. I mean, honey catches more flies than vinegar. Why would he say such a thing? Because it's the truth. And Jesus speaks the truth in love. It's the truth. It's neither kind nor loving to tell someone a lie. To go through the narrow gate, we can't take all our stuff. On the Appalachian Trail, sometimes we'll get to a place where this large tree has fallen over the path, and it's large. It's too jungly to go out around it. So you take off your pack and you shove it under the tree because there's a little bit, and then you crawl under the tree and then you get out and put it back on. You can't take it with you. There are sometimes it's rocks that are really tight. You take off your pack and put it through, and then you go through. The narrow gate, we have to take off our self-righteousness. We take off our sin. We take off our pride. We take off our judgmentalism. None of it will fit through the narrow gate. And we leave it outside. We leave it at the foot of the cross. We repent of that and we leave it behind. Not living for self, but living for Jesus and then living for others. None of that's what just comes naturally to us. It is the work of the Holy Spirit that we would, as he said at the end of chapter 6 in the Sermon on the Mount, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. It's demanding, and it's fulfilling, and all these things will be added to you. Your Father knows that you need these things. It's not easy. There is a battle. Romans 7 says there is a battle that we have within ourselves. The narrow and hard way calls us to keep our eyes on Jesus. He's the leader, and he's always going before us. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff comfort me. It's the path of life. I think one last thing. When you think of the narrow way, don't think of it as some hidden path. He doesn't say it's a hidden way. He says the gate's narrow, but it's not like hidden someplace. I think of it as a highway. And centermost, there is the path of life. It's visible. Every time the gospel is presented, the path of life is made known. Whenever Jesus is honored, where the kingdom of God is exalted, where the kingdoms of this world are properly subjected to the King of Kings, the narrow way is seen again and again. And it's often harshly rejected. It's judged, but it's seen. Only the Holy Spirit can give us the judgment and the discernment needed to repent of our sin, to drop it at the foot of the cross, and to enter by the narrow gate. But the gospel calls us to move beyond our intentions, to move beyond our endless questions and deflections, and to take Jesus at his word, and then by faith alone to put your trust in Christ as the way that leads to life. Will it be hard? Well, he says that it will be at times. But he also says, and we'll see this when we get to chapter 11, that you will be yoked to him, and that his way is easy and his burden is light. He is the one who makes the way. So may God grant us the judgment and the discernment to not get sucked into the wide and easy way that leads to destruction, but to trust Jesus for the narrow gate that leads to life, and then to walk with him day by day. Amen. Let's stand as we sing together our hymn of response, Day by Day.
Charge that on himself he lays.
Now the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest with you and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.